Kesnur, my co-panelists, Commodore Deepak Naik, distinguished invitees, members of the media, ladies and gentlemen. Good evening, everyone. Ab initio, I'm delighted to be here amidst all of you this evening. May I avail this opportunity to extend my gratitude to the MEDC for this very kind invite extended to me to be here and share some perspectives with you. I do not have a formal structured presentation, as is my wont, but I'll do a very freewheeling overview, leveraging from my 6 years of experience in the Directorate General of Shipping. I had the singular privilege of being the Joint Director General of Shipping for about 4 consecutive years, and followed immediately thereafter as the Director General of Shipping and eventually the Secretary of the Government of India. I was very, very tempted when I saw the entire thematic strand, so I couldn't resist myself in sort of doing a fair bit of deep dive on all these 4 elements which comprise technology, innovation, education, and environmental sustainability, contextual to the merchant marine or the maritime domain in general. I think it would probably in order that we remind ourselves of the cusp of history that we are in the midst of. These are extraordinarily challenging and extremely exciting times because change, while it is a constant, the sheer pace and potency of change, which is sort of overwhelming us, is here to stay. And perhaps if all stakeholders like us do not adequately equip and address these challenges, we'll probably get thrown into the dustbin of history, as I keep saying. Not very flippantly, but I mean it very responsibly. I think it'll be useful for us also to recall what the scientist Gordon Moore once said, you know, and this is in regard to the explosion of technology. The transistors per square inch on an integrated circuit keeps doubling annually. And what he added was that this is here to stay as a futuristic trend. This is only an indication of what we are in for in terms of the rapidity and the explosion of change. Look at the fact that IT, information technology, information supplemented by information technology enabled services, which goes with the acronym of ITES, information communication technology, and the entire range of technological advancements, literally the frontiers of technology are getting breached. And it is nobody's case that the merchant marine is going to be immune from this. So let me just characterize to you on a very illustrative basis some of the developments that have transpired in the immediate past and perhaps also going forward as to what is in store in the realms of the medium term and the long term. Those of you who are familiar with the merchant marine, which is the merchant shipping sector, probably might recall that at some point in time, let's say around 20 years ago, the crew complement used to be about 50, 60 strong on an average per merchant ship. Today, it's come down to about no more than about 17 to about 22. That's the range. And that is explained or accounted by the fact that you've had increasing dosages of electronization and digitization on board these vessels. Look at the bridge, look at the engine room. Wherever you look at it, there is an infusion of technology in an extremely massive way. So consequently, the challenge is that while there is a boom in technology, infusion or induction into every merchant vessel, you have fewer crew to man these ships. So therein lies the rub of the challenge, where they need to equip themselves with new skill sets to be able to cope up with all that is going around them. We now have, you know, the next generation of, I'm just trying to skim through for want of time, because I plan to cover pretty much all the facets. Look at the fact that now we have now committed ourselves to build the next generation of LNG ships. We have committed ourselves in terms of building 6 new ships, of which 3 have already been sort of an MOU stands entered between South Korea and the Cochin Shipyard Limited. Extremely state-of-the-art vessels, and this is a demonstration of what is the impending technological advancement that we're going to be seeing in the merchant marine sector. So you have an entire array of the merchant shipping fleet which is now being impacted or influenced very saliently by these technological advancements. There's not one segment of the merchant marine which is not getting influenced by these developments. Let me just look at the VTS, the VTMS, the vessel traffic management systems, highly sophisticated, state-of-the-art, very advanced, the way they manage the port and the other services. I'm again tempted to mention to you that we have in the Directorate General of Shipping an extraordinary level of sophisticated technological equipment which we have been leveraging since about 2009. It goes by the acronym of Long Range Identification and Tracking, LRIT as it is known. In this, almost on a 6-hourly basis, and of course going forward, almost on an hourly basis, real time, pretty much thanks to satellite technology which gets leveraged and invoked, we are able to view real time every single Indian flag merchant ship anywhere in the world, globe, or wherever it is on the move, and within a radius of around 1,000 nautical miles, any foreign flag ship. This is contributing hugely to maritime domain awareness. It has implications in maritime safety, maritime security, and a whole range of applications. We've now had the next generation of what is called as the IRNSS, Indian Regional Navigational Satellite Systems. So here we have been able to pick up from around the 2014 launch of the variant of these new satellites, and we are able to now go into a phase where we are able to monitor almost on an hourly basis. So what is going to happen with the merchant vessels with the level of sophistication is that the command and control structure on shore will have to be repositioned, re-engineered as it were, recalibrated to ensure that this has to be adequately monitored, suitably serviced, so that the lean and mean crew complement is able to handle any contingency should it arise. So that's the challenge. I quite see, and this is manifest, that in about 15 to 20 years, and this is not a doomsday prophecy, this is actually crystallizing as a very significant paradigm shift where you're going to have autonomous vessels. You may possibly state that a completely autonomous vessel, which is unmanned, could be in the realms of around 2 to 3 to 4 decades, or perhaps not at all, but you could end up having just about one or two crew handling this level of sophistication. And at the back end, at the shore, you will have an entire command and control structure which will look after and service the entire array of needs, maintenance, operations, and what have you of these vessels. The fact that artificial intelligence, machine learning, blockchain technology, data analytics, business analytics, drone technology, it's here to stay, and I think this is the new normal, if I may put it that way. This is a reality, and the fact that this has applications already in the logistics supply chain management sector and to a large extent in the merchant marine, I think we need to, it's a wake-up call, because I think in terms of upgradation of skill sets, human resource development and capacity building, we are quite frankly lagging way behind in trying to cope up with the infusion of these technology. I'll just park my thought on technology with just one final strand. This is in regard to what is called as the port community system or the cargo community system. Those of you who are actually interfacing with the ports on a day-to-day basis are probably privy to the fact that virtually every stakeholder is connected to the maritime and the port sector on board an electronic platform known as PCS currently, in with reference to the government-owned ports, which is the major ports. And now there's a new shift towards a cargo community system, which is anticipated to subsume not just the 13 government-owned ports, the major ports, but also the 187 odd so-called non-major minor ports, which are primarily in the either with the control of the state governments, the union territories, or increasingly the private sector. So what happens in this PCS or the CCS is that pretty much everybody talks and connects on this vertical. And this humongously facilitates all transactions in real time. There are glitches. Admittedly, all is not well. But I think the sooner we realize the value proposition in this, I think the better for all of us going forward. Let me then just move to sustainability. Regrettably, I think, except the very conventional, traditional thought processes which are connected to the merchant shipping sector in relation, let's say, to MARPOL, Marine Environmental Pollution Regulations of the International Maritime Organization, which is the shipping regulator for the globe, under the UN system as a specialized organ of the United Nations. Barring that, the ballast water management technologies which have now come into force, now you have, you know, there is another technology which is coming about. I think other than this, to my mind, a very holistic approach on sustainability management has been in deficit in the merchant marine. Let's look at our commitments, our national commitments, sovereign commitments that you have made to the UN SDGs, the Sustainable Development Goals, which the previous speaker briefly touched upon. There are 17 goals, 169 targets. It's not enough for the governments to commit. You know, this is spanning the time horizon of 2015 to 2030. It is incumbent on all of us as stakeholders down the line, on a top-down or a bottom-up approach, as you wish, to be aware, get sensitized, and have ownership of each of these so that we are able to contribute to the next generation, which is hopefully is going to be better. Which is why I keep advocating in fora after fora that stakeholders like you, it is incumbent that you propagate this message. And I keep saying, go beyond the IMO. Look at IMO Plus. Look at the overarching UN system. There are these commitments which we have made, and we pledge ourselves to stay that course. I don't know how many of you are aware that there is a parallel paradigm known as the UN Global Compact. How many of you are aware? If you could please raise your hands. This is exactly the challenge to me as I quite see it on a national scale. The UN Global Compact is a voluntary paradigm where international businesses across geographies and across verticals are expected to voluntarily commit, contribute, and pledge themselves. There are 10 principles enshrined in the UN Global Compact. This is meant only for the business community. It cuts across, it straddles the entire spectrum of business. I'm reminded of Principles 7, 8, 9, which is in relation to environmental sustainability. There are others in regard to anti-corruption, labor laws, and what have you. I mean, we need not immediately get into that. Principle 7, simply put, says that businesses will be fairly guarded, mature in dealing with environmental challenges. And this is precisely the approach which has been advocated by the UN on a multilateral level. Principle 8 says that the industry, commerce, trade, and all connected stakeholders shall do whatever it takes to contribute to sustainable management, which means climate change action, ecological life cycle management, carbon emissions control, and the like. Ninth one, which is equally applicable, is that the industry through R&D will propagate and sustain the uses of new technologies to address the environmental challenges of the future. So may I urge, exhort all of you that please get aware of the UN Global Compact. This is meant for the business community on a universal level, and that you need to understand the implications of this and spread the message on a very disseminated mode. Just two elements, Captain Kesner, if you'll bear with me, I'll just take a few minutes. You know, we have had challenges across the coastline. We have been privy to some major maritime incidents in the last year or two. near Chennai, somewhere across, in proximity to the Mumbai coast as well. So there have been oil spillages, there have been unfortunate accidents, catastrophic consequences to the marine life, to some extent perhaps to human life as well, and the sheer disruption that comes in the wake of that. So what happens typically is, as first responder, the Coast Guard gets into action, because under the NOS DCP, which is the national document going back to the year 1997, National Oil Spill and Disaster Control Management Platform, the Coast Guard gets into the act of being the first responder there. Then the DG Shipping comes in and the whole array of stakeholders jump in. But I think it has, over the years, what we have seen is that we need to supplement this with a new paradigm which is fairly prevalent in the Western world, the more mature economies, if I may put it, where they have something called as the OSRO, Oil Spill Response Organizations. OSRO is the acronym for that. What you then do is, it's a fairly cost capital intensive proposal, but I guess if you work it out over a period of time and if you annualize it, it can then get to be cost effective as an application solution. So if you have the OSRO, and this is a model that we need to look at, is to ensure that the best in class service providers are available at our beck and call, duly requisitioned through an MOU or an agreement, formalized, and as and when should a catastrophe along the coastline occur, we are able to requisition the services, and they have absolutely state-of-the-art vessels, manpower, technology, and the whole array of works. So it's time that we need to address this question of having OSROs along. I think the sooner we get into that, the better for all of us. Finally, in regard to sustainability, all I would like to say is sustainability is not just a mantra to be mouthed as a platitude in fora like this. This is something we need to imbibe, and imbibe along the entire supply chain management of the maritime sector, which means, let's say you start from procurements, you start from your input, you apply sustainable management practices there, you look at inventory management, you look at the output of the finished product, look at the service. There's, immense potential. All you need to do is to apply the principle of sustainability, because at the end of the day, sustainability, ladies and gentlemen, it makes business sense. Please understand that investment is worth the while, because in due time, exponentially the returns, the ROE, the ROI comes into you. And may I also say that you need to also look as a socially responsible partner at something called as an NVA, net value addition to the community. That's an equal sovereign commitment which we all need to make. I'll then hop, skip and jump to the concept of ideation, innovation, research and development, and IPRs. This is an area, India is known as the fourth largest technological superpower in the world in terms of our prowess of engineers, in terms of institutions under the CSIR, number of technical institutions of excellence represented with the IITs and what have you. But at the end of the day, our spend on R&D is pathetic. Is less than 1% of the GDP. It does no good to the country that if we have this dismal figure of investment. And this is not something which it has to be, the envelope has to be pushed only by the government. It's equally the responsibility of the private sector. You can do it on an individual basis, on a collective basis, pooling resources, on a PPP mode as well, public-private partnership as well. You need to sort of step up. That's where I keep saying, there is a famous book by Nicholas Nassib Taleb. I don't know how many of you heard, a book written called as Skin in the Game. The Black Swan. These are some of the books that this author has authored. So what happens when you have skin in the game, when you invest and commit, the returns are exponential over a period of time. So you don't need to get inhibited. So I would strongly urge you to read that and use that as a takeaway. Innovation is sadly lacking in the merchant shipping sector, and I'm being brutally candid on that. I've kept saying in the 6 years of my tenure, this has been a huge discount. The industry is just not, doesn't have the stomach and the inclination to go in for ideation and innovation. A time has come, probably we'll get left behind. And let's just compare ourselves with our Western counterparts. Let's look at Europe and some of the other jurisdictions. In terms of maritime technology, I think we are trailing probably a generation. We are behind by decades. You look at some of the IPRs, intellectual property rights, which when you commercialize R&D into IPRs, copyrights, patents, trademarks, geographical indication, and what have you, the entire works, I think we need to look at this very closely and say that. And this is where I keep saying there is also this allied adjunct facet of a think tank. Because somebody needs to do, as an industry, a very focused trend analysis as to what the future holds, what are the technological disruptions that are going to be in play in about the short term, the medium and the long term. Understand that on a perspective and holistic basis, and then factor into your business decisions. And how do you do that? You need to scale up and have a think tank which is very agile, which is very nimble, and which is not very bureaucratic, to be honest. So that's the way forward. I think since I'm probably, I think it will be unfair for me to go beyond, I'll just touch upon the need for education, capacity building, your human resource development. We have in the merchant shipping sector close to about 156 maritime training institutions approved by the Director General of Shipping. They deal with the entire range of pre-sea, post-sea competency courses, refresher courses, the whole range works there. Unfortunately, and I'm more than happy to be quoted, and I keep saying this, barring about a dozen institutions which really deliver in terms of excellence and quality, the rest are absolutely pathetic. I mean, their contribution is literally zilch. So the commitment in terms, you know, which is, again, I come back to that. Everybody looks at ROE, ROI. I quite understand. I mean, for a lot of these folks, it's an investment. It's clearly a commercial or a business venture. Makes perfect sense. But for God's sake, please look beyond. You're playing with the lives of the future generation of mariners. And to me, the human resource element is probably the most significant of all resources. And you can only play with this at the cost of the future of the nation. So you need to commit. So we try to reform this sector. We brought in a comprehensive inspection program. Hopefully that has reined in and brought some method in the madness, if I may put it. Perhaps going forward, we can look at that. But I think what we did, and I'm happy to say that this happened during my tenure, I'm saying this utmost humility because of the contributions of all our colleagues. We introduced what we thought was two very futuristic paradigms. The concept of e-learning. Because a classroom learning is now literally OTOs. I mean, you need to have it to a certain extent, but it needs to be supplemented by virtual learning. Blended learning, which means that you need to compositely look at virtual learning techniques with physical learning, on-site learning. I just give illustrations from the IIT. You know, the seven top IITs, the older ones, they promoted what is called as NPTL, National Program of Technology Enabled Learning, where there is distance. This is made available to engineering institutions across the country for gratis, for free of charge. Whatever is taught in an IIT classroom is made available through NPTEL so that you are able to then gain critical mass and excellence. Look at MIT in Boston in the US, Massachusetts Institute of Technology. They came out earlier with something called as a courseware. It's a free contribution in the open source domain where, again, similar technology, all that is taught in MIT is made available free for engineering and technology students across the world. So the e-learning solutions are the way forward if you're looking at a huge mass of students to be catered or serviced, which is where we stepped in the Director General of Shipping. We created a customized module of e-learning exclusively for the merchant shipping sector, straddling, except the naval architecture discipline, the nautical and the marine engineering sector, where we populated an extraordinary amount of material which is available on the website of the DG, freely available to all Indian sailors. They need to just have an Indian national INDOS identity, which is a given free of charge, and they can access this. The unique characteristic of this is that it is highly interactive. And then, you know, there are all kinds of automated techniques which take you from one level of learning to the other. There are online assessments, all free of charge, which evaluates you and tells you where you are deficient. It then leads you in the system itself to a particular course so that you can upgrade your skill. And then there are back-end sessions, chat sessions with mentors who are on a physical level or an online basis. They're able to then coach and guide you. The idea was to upgrade skills. Then we also thought that the next level to go to scale up, is the e-exams. You know, exams have been a huge bane in DG Shipping, much maligned, because you have the physical exams and then you have the oral exams. What we did very simply is we re-engineered, rewired this paradigm. For oral exams, since there were a lot of complaints, what we did is we did a very simple no-brainer. We just introduced the CCTV cameras, effective from December 2015 when I was a DG. I said, when you have a CCTV camera, and we said we are willing to provide footage to the trainee as well as the trainer. So you call the bluff of either the trainee or the trainer, because the technology and visuals don't lie at the end of the day. So in about 90 days, you're free to file an appeal and get it. So trust me, in about a year time, before I left office eventually, in end of 16, the entire volume of complaints came down, because a lot of allegations, counter-allegations made. So this is a very simple solution we introduced. Now, on the physical thing, what we did is we rationalized it. We introduced something called as, we did this iPad exams, which we tied up with the Institution of Marine Engineers. We collaborated with them, and we've introduced the entire range of certificate of competency exams, which are the career progression exams for the mariners, on this iPad, that smart tablet. So you have subjective course, subjective questions. Yep, I quite understand. The objective questions, the drawing and designs, everything on that. So immediately you get your score for the objective type drop down, and then at the back end, this is again evaluated, and we get, so this is a fairly robust system. The DG, finally what I would want to say is that the DG Shipping has now introduced a mechanism in terms of e-governance, and which we think, which is long overdue, because this is the National Maritime Administration of India, and unless we led by example, I think then we would be failing in our duty as a responsible flag administration. So what we did is we put out almost 90% of our services online. There's no physical interface. You don't need to come to the office of the DG Shipping for any service. You file applications online, upload the documents online, allied, pay fee online, get your approval or disapproval online, as the case may be. We believe that this is a way forward for transformation to the next level in terms of transparency, accountability, and simplicity of governance. I clearly have overshot my time, but I was tempted to give you a broad overview of what is in store in terms of all these four strands. I know we can go on and on, but I'll pause here. I'll be doing disservice to the other speakers, but I'll be happy to take questions, if any. Thank you so much for your very patient attention, and thank you once again for